Narrative Journal of Travels Through the Northwestern Regions of the United States. Chapter 4, Day 21, by Henry Rowe Schoolcraft. Read by Frank Blissett. June 13, 1820. The provisions and stores shipped from Detroit did not reach Mackinac until the 10th instant. We also found our canoes deficient both in size and construction, and that to embark the provisions of the expedition, an additional number would be required. To secure our corn, flour, bacon, etc. more completely from exposure, it was considered advantageous to get the principal part of these articles packed up in 10-gallon kegs, an arrangement that would also very much facilitate the loading and unloading, which must, at least, be performed every morning and evening. Additional sources of delay arose from military equipments, the tardiness of mechanics, and unfavorable winds, which prevented us from quitting Mackinac until this morning. Our whole force now consisted of 42 persons, embarked in 4 canoes, exclusive of a detachment of 22 soldiers from the garrison of Mackinac, under the command of Lieutenant Pierce, which occupied a 12-oared barge. This escort was deemed necessary to accompany us to the Sioux, where the Indians were reported to entertain a spirit of hostility towards the United States, and some even went so far as to affirm that they would attempt to stop our passage through Lake Superior. We left the harbor of Mackinac at 10 o'clock in the morning, with a favorable breeze, which carried us at the rate of 5 miles per hour, and passing the detour before sunset, ascended the Straits of St. Mary, 5 miles, and encamped on the west shore, opposite Drummond's Island. The entire distance is 45 miles. The intermediate places of most note are Wetard Island, at the distance of 3 leagues from Michilimackinac, and the mouth of Rapid River, which is passed at the distance of 20 miles. The banks of Lake Huron are generally low and swampy. In some places there are sandy plains covered with pine. The shore is strewed with fragments of limestone, granite, and hornblende, and the former, in the compact form, appears in situ at the few places where we had an opportunity to examine it. A ridge of highland appears on the mainland east of Mackinac, stretching off towards the Sault de Sainte Marie in a general course northeast. This ridge apparently belongs to that mountain chain of which the island of Michilimackinac is, probably, one of the disjointed links, but we are not enabled to say that this remark will be justified by geological correspondences. The detour is the western cape of the Straits of St. Mary, distant 40 miles from Michilimackinac, and situated, according to Mackenzie, in north latitude 45 degrees 54 minutes. Here our course is suddenly changed from east to north and northwest. Consequently, the wind, which was favorable thus far, proved a serious inconvenience at the moment of our turning the point. No current in the strait has, however, as yet been experienced. The mercury has not risen over 63 degrees in the shade, although standing at 82 degrees in the sun. In the course of the afternoon of this day, on landing in a small cove on the Huron shore, we saw a large porcupine upon the beach, on which one of the voyagers immediately jumped out of the canoe and killed it with a hatchet. This animal has generally been confounded by the travelers of the region with the hedgehog, which is entirely different in its characters and habits, and is not supposed to inhabit the northern regions of America, although it is frequently found in high northern latitudes in Europe, as in Norway, Sweden, and Russia. Buffon gives two engravings of the porcupine as distinct species, under the name of Lurson and Lacoando, both said to inhabit the Canadas. But there is some reason to suppose that he has described the same animal in its summer and winter dress, as the thinness and scarcity of hair on his Lurson is the principal characteristic difference. The porcupine is known to shed a great portion of its hair as the warm season approaches. This animal is called caqua by the Indians, by whom it is highly valued for its quills. The skin does not form an article of traffic, but it serves them as a vessel to hold bear's oil and as medicine bags or short pouches. The quills are dyed with indigenous plants of various beautiful colors and employed to trim the edges of their moccasins, leggings, skins, and dresses. The colors, which are red, blue, green, black, and yellow, are very bright and permanent, and a moccasin or Indian shoe which has been thus ornamented may be worn any length of time in mud and water without perceiving that the coloring matter of the quills is any way obliterated or discharged. The Indians are also very fond of the flesh of this animal, which is said to be delicious and to resemble in flavor a young pig. It fixes its habitation under the roots of trees, but being provided with sharp claws, also ascends their boughs in quest of fruit. There are four claws on each forepaw and five on the hinder ones. It has small ears hid in the hair and a long, bushy tail covered with coarse hair, white and black. It is a lazy animal, seldom going more than a mile from its habitation, has a slow motion, and is easily overtaken and killed. When attacked, it appears to rely with a foolish confidence upon its quills, which are, in reality, a very inefficient defense. It has no power to eject them, but when touched, they easily leave the skin, but will not work their way into the flesh, as has been represented. The Indians, however, employ them for boring their ears and noses. They seldom make use of the rifle in killing this animal, but run up and dispatch it with the tomahawk. The one now killed would probably weigh 8 pounds. That was Narrative Journal of Travels Through the Northwestern Regions of the United States, Chapter 4, Day 21, by Henry Rowe Schoolcraft. Read by Frank Blissett.